Okay, good morning everyone. I'm a little bit nervous because, well, it's a huge cloud. And I'm nervous also because I'm presenting a very controversial topic today. this is all my personal opinion, but anything I'm presenting today, don't take it personal. Thank you. Just yesterday I got some a t-shirt about kettles. I think a lot of you have heard of that topic about puppet and kettles. There are people just don't believe high availability is relevant in the context of cloud. So let's see. Some different thoughts today. So I'm gonna talk about high availability, an overview for those people who just happen to be here. They are confused why they are here after all. So then I will present my understanding of high availability in the context of OpenStack. And there are four types of different high availabilities, in my opinion. And then I will talk a little bit about OpenStack HA, the OpenStack HA per se. And then I will focus on some technologies you can deliver VM HA and application level HA, and where we are heading next. And finally is the crazy idea about whether HA can be offered as a service. So the first is about high availability, the concept. As you know, even we are using cloud today, we are still facing a lot of failures from the hardware, the hypervisor, the host operating system, the virtual machine, the guest operating system, your own software, your application, anything can fail. And what makes things even more complicated is we have software-defined shared storage, software-defined shared network. It's pretty a complicated setup. So it's not a trivial issue to get things highly available. There are different thoughts about high availability, whether it is needed at all. So my understanding is there are some cases. For example, not every application today are designed, architected for cloud, on cloud. There are a lot of traditional enterprise applications that are migrated to cloud. And for those users, for those customers, they really want to name their VMs. They really want to protect their VMs applications and make sure things don't broke. And there are other use cases, even you are running a public cloud, maybe you can offer high availability as a value-added service and say, do you want to pay 50% extra money if I'm offering you a high availability VM or application? Maybe that's something doable. And there are some other use cases as well. We can touch about that later. How to achieve HA. In general, there are three things to do. Number one, for whatever kind of HA, you need some kind of redundancy. From the hardware layer, you maybe need some redundancy at the register level, the bus level, chipset level. But that kind of thing is not the focus today. And even above that level, every layer of software, if you want to achieve certain kind of high availability, you need some notion, some concept of redundancy. And if you want to provide redundancy, there are things you need to pay attention to. For example, you need to make sure you have your capacity well planned. If you want to migrate, if you want to fail over, you will need to make sure you have that capacity well planned at place. So there are associated other considerations about cost, whether you can afford it. And the next technology is about detection. There are a lot of detection technologies out there today. Either you can monitor yourself using the kind of watchdog technology. If something fails, watchdog will reboot you, something like that. And you can send some heartbeat messages to outside world so that someone is watching. When you fail, they will reboot you. There are different kind of failure detection technologies. And the third is about recovery. We don't want any text messages or phone calls early in the morning or telling you, okay, my VM failed, can you reboot it? Can you recover it? High availability has to be automatic, has to be transparent, and how can we achieve that? And for recovery, there are what the user really want is no service interruption time. Can we achieve that? And I've talked about that, about high availability. It's not just availability. It means things has to be automatic, and it will run out there. You don't have to touch it. If something fails, it will recover by itself. So next, I will talk about the four different types of high availability in the context of OpenStack. First is the OpenStack HA itself. If you search OpenStack HA high availability from Google, the most information you get today is about how to ensure the OpenStack services, the compute controller, network controller, message queues database, all these services can be made highly available. That's the focus of today from the community. But I think there are something more than that you may want to pay attention to. For example, your host level availability. You don't want to use some pretty old machines that can crash in any moment. And there are more than just compute, there are issues about network storage and all the physical layer resources. And that is the foundation of the whole high availability solution. Though that is not my focus today to talk about. And the next is about virtual machine, your virtual server. Can we make that highly available? And this layer is really about how to make the virtual resources, virtual machines, virtual networks, virtual storage highly available. And how to make this high availability management easier. And the last high availability is about user applications, user services. And that is our customer, our user really care about. They don't care whether the VM failed, the host failed, and storage failed. So long as their application, their service is available, they just don't care. It's your job to make things highly available. It's not their concern. So the last thing is about application and service level availability. About OpenStack HA today, you can get a lot of information online. There is high availability guide from the community. You can download and follow all the instructions there to set up your own highly available OpenStack deployment. And today is more focused on avoiding single point of failure from whatever services in the service portfolio. And the implementation I saw today is mostly about a pacemaker CoreSync setup. And it's a Linux HA technology. It has been there for quite some time. And there are some other proposals using HA proxy or kubelibd. That's a different option. But the problem I saw is OpenStack HA as it is today is largely seen as a deployment pattern. It is not part of OpenStack project. You still need some special skills, some special expertise to get it set up right, to get its management well. So that's one problem. And another problem is it is only about deployment. It's not about after deployment runtime management. I'm wondering if any developers from the community are interested in improve this situation, make this OpenStack HA management part of OpenStack. So here is a picture I stole from Red Hat. It's about their recommended setup about HA deployment. It's not an easy thing to do. Besides pacemaker CoreSync based setup, we can see a lot of efforts from the community to support high availability. I'm calling it intrinsic support from OpenStack. For example, in Nova, you have host aggregates, but host aggregates is a concept that is abused everywhere. There are a lot of debates about host aggregates. Can I have two host aggregates overlap? Can I have one host aggregate inside another one? It's pretty flexible, but a flexible idea is a concept. It really up to you how to make use of host aggregates. The concept itself doesn't tell anything beyond that. It is sometimes associated with availability zones. And inside Nova today, we have service groups. It's kind of internal heartbeats so that you can monitor the OpenStack services, especially the Nova components, whether they are active, alive, or not. There are other supports from message queues, from Cinder, Swift, and from all other projects. People are working on this, although we are still not there yet. Sorry. Here I'm showing how you can get from OpenStack today about the service status. The upper table shows us that we have services from Nova, and when they were updated, and their status. And for Neutron, we can get almost a similar status. But this is all about OpenStack service availability per se. So next, I would like to talk a little bit about VM and application layer high availability. And the most straightforward thing to do to get a VM application level HA is to either deploy a pacemaker call sync, for example, HA stack at the VM layer. You treat the VMs as your physical nodes. Then you can protect whatever application service as you did when you were not using virtualization or cloud technology. You can do that. And the good news is this thing can be done today using Heat more easily. In Ice House release, Heat has software configuration, software deployment technology. I think the Heat core team will present that today or tomorrow. And if you are interested in that, you may want to join their design summit. And so we are software config and software deployment resources. Actually, you can make a better use of configuration technologies or such as Ceph or Puppet if you are really into that. So this is an experiment I did using Red Hat high availability extension. I set up a cluster at a VM level. Then I try to reboot one of the VMs. And you can see, well, so many things happened. The right-hand side is the node I rebooted. And after 12 seconds, the service I was protecting, that is a load balancer, started running on the left-hand side. That's on VM 1. It can be done, and it's not very slow. But the thing is, to get the pacemaker crossing set up correctly, it still needs some effort. You need a few months to get yourself familiarized with that. So that's something we can do today, but there are limitations. One thing is about ease of management. Even you can set up a cluster, HA cluster at the VM level. You still have to manage it if you want to adjust the HA policy. You want to add new resources to be protected. You want to adjust some parameters, something. You need to manage that, but it is not part of OpenStack. And the other limitation I saw is you need to develop some resource agents. It's a concept from pacemaker and call sync. It's an adapter that can tell the pacemaker layer when your application, your service is active, how to reboot it if needed, how to stop it if needed. It's an application-specific component. If you want to use pacemaker or call sync to protect your own application or service, you need to develop this and test it. And that is how things are done today to protect the OpenStack service itself. And the third thing is about intrusiveness. You have to install something into the VMs. But sometimes our customers don't accept it. They really want us to treat their VMs, their images, as black boxes. One of our customers told us, we have a lot of images that have been used for a long time. We don't want to install or customize those images. We have hundreds of them. Some are from the financial department. They don't want to touch any single bit in that image. There are some state very sensitive, right? So how can we provide high availability while treating the VMs as black boxes. So in this case, no, we cannot use server config, server deployment, puppet, ceph. You can't touch anything inside image. So we need some technology to solve this problem. And before I talk about a solution we have tried, I will show you something we can get for VM application level HA today from OpenStack. Still, redundancy. Can we get redundancy? Yes. In Nova, we have server groups. Okay, server groups is another topic for debate. there are some people really hate this idea. Server groups it should be removed. There are people really favor of this. There's no consensus on that yet. There were proposals about virtual clusters or virtual ensembles. I don't see where that is going. And if you are using heat, there are resource types today, instance group and resource groups. And for detection purpose, I think the RPC notification is widely used today. And later on, you may, as it matures, we may migrate to also notify. So when something interesting happens, you get notified. You can react to that event. And Synometer is evolving down this path. And finally, about recovery. And there are several interesting things happening in the community. Some of my colleagues are proposing fencing support into Nova, Cinder, and Swift. Fencing, for those who are not very familiar with HA, it means if I'm suspecting a node is down, I need to make sure that that node is actually down. It's down for sure. Sometimes there are cases we can't get any heartbeat from a VM, from the management network. But that doesn't mean that VM is really down. It may still occupy an IP address. It may still reading, writing, shared storage. It may still just works now. The only thing you got is, okay, I'm not getting any heartbeat. So we need to make sure that node is really down, powered off. Then we can rebuild it, reboot it, or whatever recovery actions can be taken. There's a fencing support. Our colleagues has proposed this blueprint and implementing it. And there are already reboot, rebuild, and evacuation. That's another term today. It's called remote restart. If a node is failing on one host, you may want to restart it on another host. And that is called a remote restart. The good thing about reboot or rebuild is you can keep the VM ID not changed, the IP address the same. It's completely a transparent solution. And the problem left is maybe we can leverage this support from Nova at the orchestration layer. Another support for recovery is the HA restarter resource from Heat. There are example templates if you have tried Heat. Using that template, when your VM fails, which is detected using a heartbeat sent from inside the VM, your VM is deleted and recreated. I can show you how it works later on. There are some support today, but it's still ongoing work. So how So here is how it works if you are using heat to create a HA setup using some sample templates you can get from heat templates project on GitHub. Basically, what you will do is you create a template, and in that template, you create a Nova server, that's your VM, and you create a HA restarter resource and point this HA restart resource to your VM. And you create an alarm, and this alarm will trigger HA restarter. And you associate this alarm with your Nova server. When something happens, good or bad, from inside the Nova server, you get an alarm from that alarm resource. That is how you create a setup. Here is how it works. You need to install heat CFN tools into your VM image. And in that image, there are tools called CFN push states, CFN hub. And this can be hooked to the cron D. For every 10 seconds, every 1 minute or so, you can send out a heartbeat. And here, CFN hub is a tool modeled after the CloudFormation technology. You can actually specify some service is supposed to be active all the time, so it can check whether that service is still there. If it is not there, it will trigger an alarm. And today, the implementation is these alarms are sent back to the CloudWatch API implemented by Heat, because all the implementation in old days in Heat is something similar to CloudFormation. That's where the team started. Then after that, you will get an alarm inside Heat, and there are some background worker threads checking whether an alarm should be triggered. Then you delete and recreate your VM instance. That is how VM HA can be done. I'm labeling here yesterday. Then. The Heat team has decided, okay, we are not doing anything more than that regarding the CloudFormation support. And so the API CFN, that API is deprecating. And they won't do anything more inside Heat about watch rule, about the alarm resource. So, here is what it is done. It can be done today. It's pretty similar, but there are some differences to be highlighted. We see, okay, that this event trigger, this heartbeat messaging sending out from inside instance to back to Heat, that's not changed. But for getting some metadata for your VM or your services in that VM, the team is using OS cloud config today. Okay, that means something more to inject into your VM image. Okay, but that could be acceptable. And for alarm, today you can use Xenometer. And the team believed that is the right direction to go. And whenever it is possible, you should use Xenometer to monitor and send back alarms. What's next? Okay, here is really my personal opinion. I'm still arguing this with the Heat team. So we can make this whole thing a little simpler. So we need to deprecate CloudWatch API. I think that's the decision already made by the HEAT team. Then we need something inside the VM, something there, send heartbeat or any event related to availability back directly to Sedometer and trigger an alarm there. We cannot touch the image, we can leverage Nova support to get some heartbeat messages. Here, this is a difference. If we can get some monitoring agent installed, deployed inside VM configured, you can monitor the availability of your application or service. If that is not acceptable, the only thing you can get is VM level availability. And that's something you can get a notification from Nova. And after that, we need a signal or alarm from Sedometer directly to HEAT. We don't need any proxy or broker along the path. And then the fourth and fifth thing we need to do is we need to add the resource type in HEAT to provide a notion of VM groups. And these groups of VMs, they can protect each other. If anyone fails, some other will cover it. And you can specify some high availability policies for this VM cluster resource type. And then when something really bad happens, I would like to suggest remove that HA restart resource. And actually, it is deprecating. We can leverage the support from Nova directly to do whatever you want. Reboot the VM in place, rebuild it, that means download the image again and restart it, and migrate it if it's still alive, or evacuate. We have a lot of options here. And these options can be specified when you are creating the VM cluster resource type. So it looks like a solution, but there are still a lot of open questions, as we can see. For example, can we do this? If we are deploying a group of VMs, but we don't want these VMs to share the same PDU, same power supply. We don't like this VM to share the same network switch. Can we do that? It's about the physical level placement. And there are scheduling extensions desired as well. Can we reboot this VM if possible, first. Then if I have some abundant resources, I can reboot others. That's a priority between VMs. Can we do that? It's an open question. And for failure detection, it really up to you about what do you mean by failure? If I'm expecting 10 megabytes per second throughput from my VM, but I'm only get 1 megabyte, does that mean the VM is still available to you? Maybe, maybe not. If it is not satisfying, it is not meeting my QoS requirement, I may see that VM not available. You had better reboot it, restart it. That's a different question. It's really about what your definition about availability. And reliable detection, if you really want to get a reliable detection, sometimes your application or your service need to get need to be get involved. It, only your application or your service know whether they are live. It's a pretty difficult topic. Even today, using pacemaker CoreSync, we can only check whether that process is still there, whether the PID files created is still there. If it is not there, I would suspect, okay, that service, that process is done, but it may and may not be true. So a reliable failure detection is really a difficult challenge. And the next open question is about reasoning. If I see frequent failure from a host, that means something to me. I need to check that physical host. But how can I get that insight? We need to reason about some frequent failures, frequent types of failures, and see if something we can do beforehand so that we can make sure things are really robust. You can do this by collecting logs and analyzing them, but sometimes logs are bad. Logs reveal some information you are not supposed to read. Okay. And the next question is about HA management. And so far, I've been really focused on compute, a virtual machine availability. But in a real cloud setup, the implication is more than that. You have storage, network. Well, network is really a mess. You have 1,000 ways to break it. If something is not available, can we detect it and recover it automatically and on time? That is a really difficult question. And in terms of heat support, I would really like to see VM availability evolves into a stack availability. If the whole stack is running as expected, okay, that's good. But if any component in that stack breaks, the VM is there, but it means nothing to me now. The port is gone. It means I cannot communicate. So maybe we can go one layer up to provide high availability for the end users. Next is about maybe we can leverage whatever support from the hypervisor layer or the host layer. We have already done that when providing high availability for OpenStack. We were using pacemaker CoreSync. But there are some other choices. For example, if you want to provide VM level availability and you are using vSphere, that support is out there. Why OpenStack is not using it? If you are deploying a VM on Power machines, for Power platform, you have Power HA. If you are deploying Hyper-V machines, they have their VM availability set concepts support already. So maybe we can leverage all the existing high HA capabilities from that layer. And I have some good friends working in QEMU to make QEMU capable of fault tolerance. You run one VM there, and there could be another shadow one running on another host. And in the background, the memory pages were synchronized highly frequently, maybe using RDMA. And there are a lot of interesting technology out there we can leverage from. So if all this technology can be used, maybe we can do something like HA as a service. So next is my crazy idea about maybe we need another project for HA's purpose. For this kind of a project, I'm proposing a lot of things, but it is not so complicated one. We need a generic HA management service that can be used for host level, VM level, application level, and even OpenStack HA. It's almost the same. We can do that. And we can leverage whatever support from the hypervisor layer, say the KVM or Hyper-V or whatever, vSphere. That the only thing that that is different is based on who are you. If you are an operator, you can check the OpenStack HA. But you are a user, an end user, okay, using the same infrastructure, you are not allowed to see anything about OpenStack HA, but only about your own application, your own service. But the whole infrastructure, the code base can be the same. What we need is really about some well-defined service APIs and some common HA policies that can be specified. So if that is not clear, let's see a few pictures. So here is what OpenStack HA is a pretty abstract diagram. We have here is high availability enabler technology. It could be pacemaker, vSphere, or whatever. And we can have head here is HA daemon, just like Nova Compute installed on every host. We can make this open architecture. The driver can be a plugin. We can provide this HA as a service. It has its own APIs and engines. Once we have this project, this kind of support, the whole concept can be leveraged by other projects such as Hadoop or Heat. Yeah. Just a quick switch. Here is what a VM level HA can be provided. So we still have the same, almost same enabling technologies, and VMs as the resources to be protected. What we can get from this picture is VM HA. And next is, if these boxes are VMs, what we can get here is the application HA. So most of the code base could be the same. And I don't know if some developers from the audience are interested in it, and we can work on this. But what we need is just some common APIs to create a cluster, to add a node into a cluster, remove a node from cluster, specify its policies, define resources to be protected, define resource group that is a service to be protected, and you may need to define some fancy support as well. I think that's something maybe some of you are interested in. Then if you are really interested in it, in this, you can let me know. Okay, that's the end of my presentation. So advertisement, some IBM sponsored sessions you may want to take.